Hello and good. Hello and good afternoon. How are you all? I hope everybody is keeping safe, taking care, and ensuring that they don't take too many risks in the current setting. So we're all at risk even now as we speak, but we appreciate you taking the time out and joining us for this very important webinar. I'm sure all of you will agree with me on HR data analytics. So while this is a buzzword today, and a lot of people use it as a buzzword, we thought it is important that we bring in a couple of experts who on the ground actually live, breathe, eat HR data, and hear from them how is it that they are driving data in the HR function. So without much ado, first of all, let me take the privilege of introducing you to Tony. What I liked about Tony when we first spoke was, his statement which said that he's a strong believer that human resources isn't a thing we do. It's the thing that actually and definitely runs our businesses. And he believes also that data-driven decisions have been at a core of whatever he's done, while he's definitely not shying away from the emotional quotient that he needs to bring to the table when he's discharging his job, which is that of heading the entire talent acquisition group for ConnectQ Business Solutions. And he's been a part of this organization since September 2015. Prior to ConnectQ Business Solutions, Tony was with Sutherland Global Services for almost 9.5 years. So his overall experience of 19 plus years in the industry will certainly, leave us with some gems that I'm sure each one of us will carry back when we leave from this webinar. The second esteemed guest that I have with us is Sridhar Marla. Sridhar has 17 plus years in the IT space, and he's working for one of the large fintech companies, which is Broadridge Financial Services, for more than 7 years now. He's an associate vice president, and he's worked on diverse roles in this organization. So in a way, he very nicely put it when he said that he actually started from a zero headcount and has taken it to more than 3,000 in the years that he's been associated with Broadridge. His skills and his top skills are payroll, personnel management, compensation and benefits, etc. So it's again, he's right now deep into HR data, and I think again, both Tony and Sridhar, thank you for being here and really, really looking forward to gaining some insights from you as far as data and HR is concerned. I'd just like to, start the discussion by quoting Andrew Carnegie, who was an industrialist and a philanthropist almost 100 years back. And the power that he gave his employees and actually even data to do with his employees. So, he very famously said that take away my people and leave my factories and grass will grow on the factory floors. But take away my factories and leave my people because, the way they think, the way they put plans together, the way they analyze the data that we have will actually end up creating a better factory for me. So he's of course famously known for ensuring that everybody who works with him knows that his most important asset is its people. And with that, Tony, a few words from you, please, as we get into the conversation. Tony, can you hear me? I'm not able to hear you, Tony. Sridhar, can we go over to you while we wait
Yeah.
for Tony?
Yes. Anjali, as you mentioned, rightly mentioned that people are the main asset, and we need to admit that there is no other second thought about it. And in the recent times, if you see, it's a huge increase on the data, giving rise to the big data and the analytics in the field of business and strategic domains. That's the main thing which is happening right now. And if you look at the shareholders and the customers, whoever are asking for a transparency and pushing to report the human capital, that is the most expensive as of what you look at. Apart from the
True.
infrastructure, human capital is the most effective and expensive asset on the balance sheet. And that's how like data plays a vital role in getting the human into the organization. And as you were rightly mentioning, when I joined Broadridge and when I took up the Broadridge office in Bangalore, which we started recently, it was we started with a zero headcount, and we've been there up to 1,200 or 1,250 employees when I came back from there. That means it's all about, see, the people is the main asset over there.
Right. Yes, absolutely. So, you know, with regards to HR, especially given all the changes that we are seeing and having, of course, been in the middle of a pandemic, which is totally different. It's very dynamic. It's a very evolving kind of a business environment. So whether it is, you know, resources and the demand and supply of the same, whether it is skilling, you know, just managing everything that's happening around us, diversity, with respect to career ladders, etc. Why do you think there is this sudden, you know, relevance of data in HR in today's age?
Yeah, relevance of data is always there in HR because HR lives with the data for sure, because that's the main ingredient for any HR to have. And that's in confidential, but we need to take care of the data what we have, and it is very confidential data what HR carries. And when it coming to the limelight in the recent past is all about the data part, where people are making decisions through the data analytics. And in the last, if you see, for the last 2 or 3 years, it has been more in limelight, where data analytics is playing a major role in getting the things. For example, when I look at recruitment as a talent acquisition as a function, there are no candidates which we look at as passive or an on candidates, passive or who are available, or they will be looking at longer active or something who are looking for a job. They are always looking on, and they are always looking for a greater opportunities to explore and get into that kind of a field. In that way, when you are looking at this, recruiters are relying on the data on the current real-time data, what is available, what are the people looking at, and what are the candidates looking at, and looking at the demands and insights of what is happening around. That's how the recruiters are coming and filling their gap in that. And that helps in getting them into the right decision making, and through this data points, whatever we have spoke right now. And coming to the other field, that is in my area, currently I'm handling compensation and benefits. It's all hardcore, and it's all number-driven game on the compensation benefit. Wherever you see, it's all about the data, what you have in place, and how we are approaching the data and putting it in a right format.
Yes.
And it's abundantly used now in comp and ben. Like data is abundantly used. It's been there for so long, but now it's been used as more of the HR tools are coming up, and we are getting in there.
Okay. So, Tony, I hope you can hear us now and the signal is all right. Tony, comfortable? So let me ask you this question. You know, why is it so important for you? I mean, how has it helped you as an HR professional, and how does it help business to focus on HR analytics? What has been your experience with this? Tony?
I think there's a connection problem.
Yeah, I think Sridhar, why don't you take a shot at this?
And again, when you talk about HR, it's all very contextual in nature. HR itself, the data, and we like to everything to be in black and white. And there are little gray area also, where we, in regards to building the culture of the organization and all those, where we use this data. And data, why it is very important for HR is data is the one where it adds the value to engage people and makes them to listen to you, and you can engage them with that. Without data, if you're talking, there is no point. Like just giving jargons or something and about an experience in a theoretical manner, it will not help. But
so agree with you.
HR will need the data, and so that people can listen to you, and how we can, that's how we can, that's how it is. HR is having more data and putting in a right way how the HR data, because as you know, we are everything is confidential.
You can hear Anjali and Sandhya.
I can see, but
sorry. Yeah, go ahead, Sridhar. Sorry.
Yeah, that's what the data provides, that how we can engage and make people listen about that and give better insight on to the audience to make them understand what exactly we are talking about. That's why HR always has a vital role in providing and getting the data in place.
Right, right. So just to, you know, take this a little forward, how is Broadridge, you know, and what do you think are some of the best organizations, what are some of the best organizations doing to enhance the capabilities in this area?
Okay, yeah, I can talk about Broadridge as a whole, but
sure, that will be very helpful.
The main three industries who are looking at this kind of an organization about the capabilities in this area, like financial services is the one, and the technology services is the one, and the professional services. These are the three, mainly, mostly using this kind of a data-driven
technology.
And I have just gone through a recent study in LinkedIn.
I opened in Google Chrome.
Where it says about 14% of total jobs are in HR are about analytics.
Mm-hmm.
Around 14%. And then coming up, it might go up more even in India. Say, for example, like if I... That's a recent study or a survey which was done by LinkedIn, and we got it from there.
Mm-hmm.
And, most of the companies are investing on the HRIS tools, and some of them are building internal tools. And when it comes to Broadridge, we use the external tools which we for a few of the data points and HRIS tool, and we use Workday, and there is an internal tool which we have built internally so that we can work on these kind of analytics.
That's how
we can internal tools to bridge the gap, and we can help. And if there are organizations which are very small and they might have don't have a budget to prefer and go ahead and do that, but I think that even in Excel, like one of the tools, like Excel is the one which we have started using from the day one when I started my HR career, and still that's the plays a vital role in getting the analysis done. Apart from whatever in simple analysis it can be done, Excel is the most useful tool which we have currently.
So, you know, we've at Heritage, for example, and at KK2, we work with a lot of organizations as consultants. And one of the things, Sridhar and Tony, and I would like to get your view on this is, so what we are also trying to do is use employee data, you know, the HR MS data completely, and then see if even the policies that we talk about, the policies and processes that we talk about, are built on the base of the people who are there in the organization. So how does it work in, say, your organization? Because I'll give you an example. For example, the travel policy, what we've typically tried to do is use the employees and the different levels at which the employees are in the organization, and then define and design a travel policy around that. So how has it worked with you and your organization?
See, when I talk about the project in specific, we have used the external tools, like for the recruitment talent acquisition, where we gather the experience of the candidate, experience how it is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether he is comfortable when he came for the interviews or how it is. We use Tableau as one of the tools which talks about the exit data and as well as the voice data of our associates. So, for example, exit data is we use it for retention as well as candidate experience as well.
Okay.
So that to understand better what the people are feeling. They might not be very comfortable in sharing the inputs with our HR VP, so that when the exit interview is done, they were not comfortable, and there are chances of data which is not coming in proper. We use that as an input. And there is one more which we do for a sentiment analysis. Say, for example, there is known to know what exactly happening in the organization. HR would be in right point where they know, and some people might not be comfortable in coming to HR directly and know how to give their opinion. In that right. case, one of the tools called R. R is a tool which helps in getting in the same sentiment analysis and giving our giving out the inputs about it. And
okay.
third, but not the least, we have done descriptive statistics about our talent acquisition procedure and performance management procedure and internal talent management building as well, where we use a tool called SPS, which is an IBM which we use. That's how we use it in Broadridge, and it is very helpful. Apart from using our internal tools, and we do take help of external tools as well. Yeah.
Sure. So, Sridhar, there is a request. If you can please hold the mic a little closer. Oh, you'll, yeah, sure. Okay. No problem. No yeah. problem at all. So, you know, in your experience, again, in your vast experience, if I may use that, where have you find that HR is can most effectively use analytics, you know, obviously to enhance productivity and efficiency?
See, first thing is in regards to talent acquisition, we use it. And in regards to the performance management, where the appraisals and all those are in place, we take data for the last, because we have an two cycles every year for the merit and as well as the bonus which we pay. And in that, we get a 1 to 5 rating where to gauge that employee's performance for the last few years and how we would and predicting whether he would be performing well or not.
Interesting.
That on performance management way. And even as I mentioned, there is an exit analysis which we do and see. It's not exit analysis who was going, but we predict the analysis of exit, how people would be moving forward in their, whether they will stick to our organization or they will move out. And what is the time frame they will be sticking to us and how we can help in developing that talent and see, understand better what they are looking at and how we can answer that. It's predictive exit analysis and as well as exit analysis. These are the four areas which we look at. And one more point which I have seen in the medical, the insurance coverages or the benefits which we provide to the associates.
Right.
We look at for this year and the past few years how the claim ratio was and what are the diseases or the ailments which they have been looking at. And how we can take forward and see what are the sessions or which we can give them in detail, saying that okay, if certain ailment has more kind of an expense which is happening throughout the insurance period, what we do is see if we can cover that as an ailment in the next years and see how we can restrict that kind of an analysis so that it helps in reducing the claim ratio, because once the claim ratios are high, we even get to more as an insurance premiums as well.
Oh, lovely.
That's how we predict that. And we are, at least I can't say it is 100% working, but at least it is working for an 80% of the decision making.
Okay. Yeah. Very interesting. Yeah, because I certainly for me, that was an input. So, you know, when we go and guide some of the HRs at different companies, I think I'm definitely going to use this. So, Another thing I wanted to kind of bounce off you, Sridhar, was in terms of performance and compensation, right? So while those two are very, very closely linked, is there any way in which you have used data analytics to process, say, to determine appropriate pay raises or employee roles? Because you've handled both of these. So just wanted your experience in this area.
Yes, of course. In the performance management, when you talk about the merit increases and all those, we have recently come up with a model where it talks about what is the overall performance, not only in the 6 months of the review period which you have. Say, might have a recency effect and people might perform in that. But including that, what we have done is we have taken the last cycle or at least 5 to 6 innings. Innings, we call it as, say, for example, for a year, I have cycles which I have to go through where I will be rated up about my performance and all those. I have taken around 12 kind of a cycles in that, and based on that, how the new cycle would be and the merit increases would be based on those kind of an data inputs which we get. Say, for example, at the percentages what we given, say, for example, I have a person who is a high performer, I'm not denying that he is an high performer at the rate. See, might be he has got a less rating this time, but how he was rated in the last few cycles. Because of any effect, it might have got rated low in the cycle on a point of 1 to 5 scale. That way, I can predict and see, okay, I'm doing a judgment based on what the analytics says and what all the data talks about, and give a merit increase appropriately. Where business would also give their inputs and come back with what exactly the person is and the associate would be doing. And based on that, we can understand that. And that's how the merit increases have happened recently, which is in April 2020. And that's how we have done that, based on the data point we have,
Okay, great. So, Sridhar, as we had discussed, there are a couple of questions that have come up in the poll. And the first question is, do you use data analytics in your organization to make HR-related decisions? So, you know, yes is 57% and no is 43%. So it's very neck-to-neck in that sense.
Yeah, neck-to-neck, but people understand what is the importance of decision-making, because it's all about data. When you have the right data in place and you know how you rightly have to use it, then you will get a better decision.
Absolutely.
Nowadays, I have heard there is a function which have started with people analytics, and it's one of the function which HR embedded within the HR team and saying that, okay, there is a separate role which is created.
Yes.
But currently, we don't have anything at Broadridge, but
it's
part of HR and we are doing it on our own.
Okay. Okay. Sure. The second question which has come up is, do you have a robust data management and control system in your organization? Well, yes is just 36% and no is 64%. So, you know, having heard you so far about the advantages that you have experienced by using data in your company, I think a lot more HR professionals would certainly like to get behind their management and see what could be done in terms of gathering data. So,
that would really help. But nothing said, like if you have Excel also, like MS Office would be obvious, like, you
need
to have minimal manual interventions over there, but even Excel would work really work well when you want to get some data points. And if you're very good at Excel, that would be really helpful.
So, you know, especially with the second question that is asked in the poll, I think very interestingly, we could possibly discuss that. What do you think then is the level of maturity of the HR community itself in understanding and utilizing you know, the analytics?
Okay, when it is coming to the HR community, we are I feel we are still getting there. It's been I can't talk for the entire HR community, but as per whatever knowledge I have, we are still getting there. And see, first thing is the general attributes. What we want to have is you should be having an analytical mindset for getting the data right, because if you are very good at the analytical thinking and all those, obviously you will be able to analyze things better. That's a general attribute which I feel it should be having. And you should be very well versed with the system analysis, how the processes work. And it comes only through experience. A person who is just a fresher and who wants to get into HR might not be right now fitting into the job immediately. But when you put on experience and understand the system and understand the HR processes, it would really help. That's about the general attributes which you have. And when it comes to the technical attributes, you should be having the operational capabilities. Say, that usually you will get only when you have some experience in that field. At least a minimum of 3 to 5 years of experience so that you can understand HR better. And then you can go ahead and see. There are so many courses which are coming up for freshers to do this. People analytics to data analytics in HR, and you can get more jobs. I feel that would be helpful, but it should have some prior experience or a domain knowledge, and just out of college would not help. That's as
very
my
true.
Experience what I'll get in.
I would tend to agree with you, because without the domain knowledge, what kind of analysis and interpretation of data can you do? So I would certainly agree with you there. And I have personally found that if you work first in the operational part of HR, you know, where you're really handling maybe even the simple putting the people data together. So name of the employee, age, you know, experience, qualifications, and then do any kind of analysis that you can in Excel sheet, even that helps you. So interestingly, in one organization where we did this analysis, with it's very easy to find out while the managing director was pushing for diversity, in this particular organization. And yeah. He said, no, I'm sure that I have 25-30% people in my organization. He and we were very pleasantly surprised to see that it was just at around 7%. So this was like very, very simple data and the analysis of the same. And of course, after that, he drove it and he said, I want 40% of my employees to be women. So it was interesting to go through that exercise over almost 2 years, but we've still achieved about 15%, 40 is still far away for that organization. Interesting question, and I'm not sure how to actually handle this. So I'm asking you to do it from Manichandra Kanda. How will analytics help us to retain employees in the organization? So you did talk about it, Sridhar, and so if you could just spend a couple of minutes more on the same.
Sure. Mani, good question. Like adding the data points and saying, see, how does it help is a simple question to ask. But the only thing is how the data has to be placed first. Retaining the individual. See, as I mentioned, it should be a predictive analysis rather than after putting down the papers and then we are analyzing whether why the person is leaving. And how it helps is, see, for example, there is one candidate who has been very well versed with the technology and he's been with the organization for a couple of years and he's doing well and suddenly he wants to resign. Mm-hmm. This can happen anytime. But what exactly we have to look at is, see, it should be a predictive analysis where whether the data is in place. See, first thing is we need to have the data in place. What is the overall exposure in the organization? How he is performing for the last few cycles? And what is its areas of interest where, see, I see that the social media also helps a lot in getting that information. Say, for example, I have a Facebook account or an Instagram account and I do chat with my people. It's all PII data, but we have analytics which we can get it from there as well, where it helps in saying, okay, and the connect which helps with an individual. Apart from the data, you should have the connect with the individual. The HRBP more now in this norm of the COVID times, it's the connect between the associate as well as the manager as well as the HR would have been a little difficult in these kind of a situation. But I usually prefer that connect should also be there apart from the data and how we can analyze that and how we can put in that. Obviously, it can't be 100% results you will achieve on each and everything, but at least you can go there and you try that and at least 60-70% we can retain that individual.
Sure, absolutely. So again, just an experience I had last week, Sridhar, and this was about we're all in the middle of complete chaos right now, of course, but there was this particular employee who put in her resignation. And what really helped, and what you said made a lot of sense to me, because what really helped was when we went back and not only did we look at when has she joined the organization, the function that she's been a part of, her performance, but the HR person who was, the HR BP for that particular function had a good connect with that individual. And she then very systematically wrote out the reasons why this lady wishes to resign now in the middle of a pandemic, that too. So putting all this together, we were able to actually analyze the case, go back to the management, and the lady has actually been given 4 months sabbatical to take care of whatever she was going through on her personal level and then come back and join the organization. So it's not an attrition, it's just a sabbatical that the lady is taking. So great input there in terms of how do you bring all of this together and then ensure that you control attrition. So there's another question from Buddha Satya Sri Harsha, and how will it, how will you set up this entire function of data analytics and how will it help small businesses and startups? So any thoughts on that?
See, small business and startups, I think, see, data is always part of our HR, as I mentioned in my initial conversations. Like handling the data is more important. What is the data we are collecting and how are we saving it in our systems, and either it may be an extra also. Sometimes due to the budgetary constraints or something, people might not afford the tools and data.
Yes.
But at least we have to maintain that in an Excel format, whatever the available resources we have. And make sure you're using the data rightly. And see, when the data speaks, no one would be able to restrict that or ask you what is happening. At least the data, make sure you are saying that, okay, this is what I can prove. And that's kind of a testimony which you can give through the data analytics tool. For a startup, I usually say, okay, you can use the MS Excel as the initial thing and see how it works. And then you can, once that will usually help any individual or the organization.
I agree with you. I agree. And once again, in our organization, when we do, you know, advise and consult with startups, the first thing we tell them is whether you're 7 employees, 70 or 700, even if you don't have a tool, just get your people related data onto an Excel sheet and let's start from there.
Yes.
So I think that makes you feel, you know, so much more empowered also, because you are talking and discussing every single point with the management based on the data that you have.
Yes. So that's how the management also hear you. Otherwise, they don't even bother what is happening. At least you need to show that with the data, saying this is what has happened and that this is might happen kind of an analytics.
Oh, yes, I agree. So again, very interestingly, there's a performance management exercise that's happening at one organization. And this is a small SME. And interestingly, as happens in a lot of large organizations too, I guess, is 87% of the people, despite, you know, having been in lockdown in the middle of, again, a global pandemic, have been rated A star, you know, forget the A, B, C, but actually A star. And we really had to go back and see what was it that made so many managers and so many employees hence get A stars in that organization. So now we're digging back and seeing what has happened over the years and why are we suddenly seeing so many A star people in that organization. So another question for you, Sridhar, is about you know, some tools that you mentioned, and if you could once again share the names of the tools that you use for the different functions.
Sure. There are around 9 different tools which we use. Only 3 out of them, but in the market they are available. And the first being the R. It's all about HR analytics and well suited for exploring the massive data uses. Say for example, if you have a massive data and massive data sets to be done in that tool would be really helpful. Then we have Python. Python is one of the programming languages, and it is very easy to learn as well. It's very easier to learn as a normal. Yes. Like, you shouldn't be a techie as such. You can, without a non-techie, can also get in there and get it done. And Excel is one. Excel also, whatever we have learned, would mean we have stopped it at an HLOOKUP or a VLOOKUP or something like that. We can do more than what we are expecting. For that, I think we need to have an macros and so that we can understand it better. That is one. It is all about, we shouldn't forget the basics. Excel is the mother of all. They say, for example, Excel, we can get and it's more easier and we can understand it better and we can just, and we won't be using it from our college days as well, so that it would be more useful that. And business and Power BI tool from Microsoft, that is one. Which talks about visualization and it talks about aggregation analysis and that's about Power BI. And we have Tableau. Tableau is the one which talks about business intelligence and the outcomes of visualization would also be there. We have a few more like SPSS, which is an IBM tool. Vizier is one of the tools which talks about people analytics in specific, which talks about data aggregation, data aggregation and service build to answer questions about the workforce. What exactly they are thinking, like the service can also be conducted over there. And and one more thing in the busier thing is it can integrate different systems like HR systems and connect them into one HR BI tool. Different systems and it can integrate it very well.
Sure.
These are the few which I know of, I think.
Sure. So, Tony, can you hear us? And are you comfortable now? Tony, are you able to hear us? No, I don't. Not as yet, I guess. Okay. So, Sridhar, I just wanted to add to the discussion around tools. So, like you rightly said, I think the most powerful, according to me, especially when we're looking at, you know, companies that are still adopting and adapting to the use of HR analytics. So if you leave me to it, and if I have to, you know, use a tool to start with, I would go with Excel, hands down. Yeah. You know, so because I think that is very versatile, actually. And most of us, like you rightly pointed out, I think most of us use about 15-20% of the features and not beyond. But I think if we're able to do that, and of course, there are enough and more HRMS tools that are available. Of course, our partner Keka is, you know, very much there across the country. So I think when you use, say, either a basic form, which is Excel in that sense, but very robust, or an HRMS tool such as Keka, I think the kind of analysis that finally you need to do has to be very customized to what your management wants from you and what, you know, what are the answers that you're trying to give to your management. So is there an HRMS tool as such that you are using in or is it these diverse tools?
No, we are using an internal tool called Workday. It's an Workday.
Okay.
We have an tool which we work, an internal tool called iCare is the one which we have built internally for all the associate databases.
Okay.
Workday has a lot of analytical like presentations which you want, and you anyways the data is all in place, and whatever you ask it will throw up in a quick second.
I see.
And
okay.
It has that ability. Workday has that ability, and there are so many other tools like HRMS tools which are very much available, and they do the analytics part of it as well.
Right. Yes. So another question, another poll question was, you know, what's the biggest challenge of your analytics journey? And 28% have said it's just getting data. 33% is processing the data, and 38% is getting key insights with the data. So from a getting data perspective, when you started, how was your experience?
Starting from my career, I think we have used the Excel only. But when it comes to Broadridge, there are instances. See, when you are not getting the data, you will not be able to get to the right decision for sure. You have to have the right kind of a data, and processing would be more easier. That would be a second step which would be coming in, which anyone, any tool can answer that, and we can do it on our own. But getting data is more important, because as I mentioned in my initial conversations, PII data, which we are handling, entire organizations, like including the personal information, whatever we have. And if we don't have the data right, then it would be very difficult for us to get the, that is the minimum basic thing is you need to have the data first. Otherwise, it is very difficult. And that you need to start from the day one. It's not like we are, might be there are some skill sets or which we need to add on to it and get in mid of the year or something like that is a different thing. But starting when the person comes into the organization, we need to gather all the data, what is required. And it all comes through experience, because if you find that, okay, this data is required and this helps in analyzing some input, of course, we need to take that and add on to that and go on updating it on a day-to-day basis. It's not like we do it today and we will do it after a month or so.
Yeah.
The data wouldn't be helpful for sure.
In my
experience, that's what I found there.
Okay, sure. Yes, I agree with you, because once again, given our experience, given my experience specifically, I think I've always gone back and told HR folks that if you don't have data, start building it up. Because unless you do that, then, you know, it becomes very difficult to go back. You can't be talking qualitative all the time. So it has to be quantitative, and then you add on the qualitative flavor and management will hear you out. But just being, just, you know, going back to anybody, business heads, management, or even your HR colleagues with qualitative inputs is not going to help. So a question I just saw from Ashwini Kanolkar is, how does data analytics help us in talent acquisition?
Talent acquisition, as I said, like through LinkedIn or whoever it is, we are getting that. As you mentioned, like we don't have any specific ingredient from there. Say, for example, if I'm looking for a candidate for a particular skill set, and we know that skill set is very niche in nature, and we'll not be able to get that skill immediately. And it's not like, okay, suddenly I decide today and get in that person. Is not helpful. What you have to do is you need to build your own database and see what is that organization looking at and what are the skill sets which are helpful for us in the near future. And what, for that, you need to understand the business first, whether what kind of a technology, because that kind of an exposure we should have with the business and the technologies, what they use for our business.
Based
on that, we can pull out the data and get it in the data in the right place and then do it. That obviously helps us in any part, like as not only the talent acquisition, when the associate comes and joins us and the employee comes and joins us, it would be really helpful in maintaining and improving his performance as well.
Surely. So a related question in a sense from Dandita is, you know, what kind of tools could be used for an recruitment related analytics, and what are the metrics that ideally should be tracked to understand the health of recruitment?
Tools, as I said, like for the metrics and all those, we can, what we are using in the current scenarios, R and Tableau are the ones which help us in getting the data correct.
Okay.
And, that's matrices, if you look at the time, the TAT, how the person, the position is getting closed, and what are the skill sets which are available in the market, and what are the skill sets we are looking at, and to hire for both PBO as well as the product development, where every technology we work on. We need to see what is that. Like there are, we work on age-old technologies like mainframes as well. Like there are, and even AS400 is one of them. Mainframes might be very new, but AS400, which is very first technology which has come up with on the mainstream domain, and even we are able to get and fill the positions immediately, because we have the data in place and we know what is happening in the market and who are the ones who are applying. And it's not about only the function, but at least the data is in place and we are going ahead with that. It would really help if we have that kind of thing.
So sure. And just to add on to what you said, which is extremely important, Sridhar, is, you know, in terms of, so we were doing hiring for another client of ours, what we also found was, once again, I'm going back to Excel and tracking the health of a recruitment system, as Dandita had asked. What we're doing is just recording, you know, the resumes as they come in, whatever details that I can get from the resumes. But against a position, I'm also asking the recruitment, the specialist, to go ahead and put in simple things like, when did I even send this resume to my hiring manager? When did I get a response from my hiring manager? You know, when did the interview happen? So how long does it take for this entire cycle to be completed is one metrics that I ask them to track. The second metrics is, so if I present 10 resumes or 5 resumes or 20 resumes, you know, what is my hit rate? So every time if I have to present, I mean, 25 resumes, it's going to really stretch my bandwidth as well as the hiring managers. So how am I increasing my efficiency for recruitment as a function, and ensuring that it is made healthy by doing exactly what you said? Unless I understand the domain that I am in, unless I understand the function for which I am recruiting, the position, the level, etc., I can only do so much. You know, my recruitment function is going to be unhealthy unless I pay attention to all of these aspects. And finally, and also very importantly, I think, how much am I spending in order to even get the resume on the resource who's my recruitment specialist, on Naukri, on LinkedIn, etc., etc.? So tracking that, the sources of my resumes and the amount I'm spending on those sources is another important analytics that I'm keeping a tab on. So Nandita, I hope that in a way helps your question. So Sridhar, again going back to where we kind of began. So when you started your journey, in HR, and you said that you were possibly using only Excel there, to where you have come now over so many years and having seen so many successes. What would you say, how important is the role that analytics has played in your journey?
Yeah,
that was
the analytics is, it's a day in, day out, we use that. Even when it comes to a data or the data points or any decision making. Yeah, hello?
Sorry to interrupt everyone. Anjali, could you, Tony, can you hear us now? We can hear you, Kyunki. Tony, can you hear us? I think Mr. Tony today is not going to join. So, okay, please carry on. No? Was checking the last time. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you. Okay.
Yes. Coming to the HR, HR as a function itself, it has the ability to curate the data points, whatever we have, either we select, organize, or present the data. As an HR, we need to have that ability to curate, and which comes only through experience. It's not like, from the data I would have been done that and given great results out of that to data points what I have. And the second thing is simplify the data. Whatever the data you have, you should simplify the data. And data is not about the graphics or visualizations, how it looks on the presentation. But it should be all about the storytelling, and it will help people
even focusing on the key insights.
Very nice.
How you are using the data of for the storytelling, not just showing the numbers on the presentation and say this is how it is. Until unless there is no story coming out of it, there is no use of the data or the presentation which you prepare. That's what I think. And that's been I've been practicing from, I don't say from the day one from my career start, but I have learned through my journey for the last 18 years.
Nice, very nicely said. So another question from Prakash K. Sridhar, which is, what kind of data should HR use to decide whether attrition is good or bad? And any best practices in specifically the IT industry around this?
What kind of a data?
To decide whether attrition is good or bad.
No, attrition is good or bad, you will get to know only once the person is having that connect with the HRBT. Because what happens, there are people who abscond. That abscond who join immediately in a day and they just abscond because of several reasons which we can't even stop. Sometimes that might be there. Then they were expecting something and they couldn't get that. But good or bad attrition, good attritions are the ones who are people when you... See, I don't see anything as a good attrition because when that has to be done in the initial stages of our recruitment itself.
When we have
that data within place saying, okay, what is the person and where is he coming from? Why is he leaving? And what is the entire experience? How many jobs he has switched?
Yes.
From that only we can get the good and bad attrition trends.
Yes.
Where you see, okay, if someone has joined and left, that as a fresher, that might be several reasons because of main constraint which we had. I'm not sure about that. But people who are, when we are having a lateral, it's our prerogative where we need to check whether this person would stick to the organization, what is his previous experiences and how he has handled that. And that's how we can draw a line between bad attrition and good attrition. When it comes to the organization, how to detect that, as I mentioned, we need to do a predictive analysis, having an initial touch with the associates and having work business in close, knowing the person in detail about the person from the business, how is he performing, and the data what we have from the performance management, where how is his ratings are, and the data what we do for a service to understand the employee engagement. those would also help us. The initial service we do for employee engagement, and the data once he joins the organization, where we do a 30, 60, 90 day service, how the person, these all would help. It's not only one point where we can say that, okay, this data would help, but each and every point from the day the person has been interviewed to the day he joined our organization and the day how he is spending in the time in the organization. These all would help, I believe.
Right, where absolutely.
Stop the good attrition
yes. And I think I'm sure you'll agree with me if I say that, you know, it is good to have some attrition always, because it kind of
flow, and the new water should come up and the old water should go.
Correct. Yes.
People who are really good at, we need to see how we can retain them as well.
Absolutely.
Very good at that. Technology-wise as well as attitude-wise and everything.
Yes. So another question that came up in the poll, again, interesting results, is on a scale of 1 to 5, how do you rate your own expertise in analyzing data? So 33% of our folks have said good, which is very encouraging. 26% have said can be better, and 31% have said okay. So in this regard, there is a question which is asked by... I have missed that in the beginning, but is there a good book that you can refer, Vinod Kumar D? So is there, have you tried to read any book regarding this? Or?
I haven't read any in regards to analytics. I have seen few articles and which we have gone through.
Okay.
It's not specific in nature, but in to name that, okay, this is a book you can read and get it. I was always mentioning theory is all just on the book and you just understand the concept of it.
Yes.
But to understand that, you need to be in a, you need to understand the domain first. Like, what
yes.
is HR? What does HR do from onboarding to exit? These all experiences and what you learn from them, then you will get an idea about what the theory is that and what you are experiencing. Theory is totally different. When I was in MBA, I thought, okay, this is how the organizations would work. After getting out of the college and getting into the real on the job, and then you understand, okay, what are the things which you will face. It's not theory is all matters, it's all about the experience which matters.
Yes, and so true.
As I mentioned, there is no book, but there are a few sessions which would happen. Like, I recently gone through one website called AIHR, UK based. Certification, they provide certification, and the curriculum they go with, it has more details about that. How people analytics can work and how data analytics would work, and which would help you in getting in there. But
because
you need to have a minimum experience and understand the domain about HR.
There's no shortcut there.
Yeah,
sure. That Dave Ulrich, he, like you rightly said, not only does he write good articles and give us good insights, but there is a good book by him, I think HR Scorecard, and I think that's what Barun has also mentioned in the chat. So that's one good book that could be referred to. So thank you for sharing the AIHR link, because I'm sure a lot of us will look that up.
Yes. I think the curriculum, when I gone through it, it is really good, and it's a 40-hour learning, and even the certification is also not that costly.
So quite early on in the session, Amar Roshan had asked a question around how do you translate qualitative data into quantitative data to understand patterns and red flags. And in your experience, did you see any situations, and how did you handle this in your decision making?
Okay, I think it should be quantitative data to qualitative data, if I'm not wrong.
Qualitative to quantitative is what Amar has mentioned here.
But the data is qualitative or not, we will be looking at it and saying, okay, this is, but see, as I mentioned in my initial conversation only, the data has to be perfect clear. There shouldn't be any misses in the data. If I'm looking for a data of 100 people, all 100 people should have the data, whatever columns I'm looking at. If I miss even a single column or some data, the data outcome wouldn't be helpful.
Right.
And coming to my experience, so how I use the data in the recent past is like exit analysis, doing exit analysis, and how it could be in the next, and even having the budgetary, deciding the HR budget as well, I've used that analysis where what is the last year budget, what we have used, and where most of the people had gone for a certification or something. And I can predict that, okay, this time, this that's how I could predict and say, okay, for this year, I need a kind of a budget. So that to handle the queries or handle the observations of all the associates or the employees if you come into. And the third one, which I talked about, which I can talk about, is the insurance, where looking at the ailments and how are the, see, if I look at the data, what I have in the last few years and the recent one as well, the data, if we have most of the data or the insurance has been used by the dependents only. We have a 1+5 dependent policy where associates who are using is minimal and 80% of that would go to the dependents. We are still continuing with 1+ because most of the organization are not sure that they are providing the 1+5 dependent, like where parents are also covered in the insurance. But we are still doing it and seeing the data about what is happening in the past and how people are using it. Providing and getting an insurance out for an aged people would be really difficult. And it is COVID times, it is, that's how, after looking at all the data points, what the broker has mentioned to us and internally what we have looked into, that's how. These are the three things which we are usually helping in. And candidate experience also is the one which we have used the data points, what we are getting. And when we collect on the day of person when it comes for the interview, where he gives data points which we collect as an, we have a candidate experience spot also.
Sure, sure.
Care of all that and, gets the data in place first. So that, sure, that data can be used and visualized and get the data, right data points over there.
Sure, sure. Certainly, because, go ahead, Sridhar.
There could be a lot of investment into it, and so that we can get in there and get the right data, and that's how we can use in our decision making as well.
Sure, absolutely. What I only wanted to add was, there are different things that we do in organizations, and if I could take the example of either a experience regarding induction or an experience regarding or data that we collect from our conversations and discussions that we have around exits, these are typically qualitative data. But then there is a pattern that you see in the same. So a lot of companies, when they start analyzing their exits, for example, put it as, why have employees exited? Because it's a personal reason, it's a family reason, it's better opportunities, etc. Now, these actually become your qualitative data points. But over time, you can convert this and even give it numbers. So when people say better opportunities, you could say number one, family reasons could be number two. And then you've made converted qualitative data into quantitative data, and then you analyze it. So that's how, Amar, it's done. And that's how research also actually is done. So you get a lot of qualitative inputs. You give them some numerical descriptors, then those numbers is what you end up analyzing. But again, like Sridhar has mentioned, I think repeatedly, I remember 4 or 5 times, unless you have that connect with the employee and get that qualitative data going as well, whether it is recruitment or performance or exit analysis or whatever, it's very difficult to just, pure data analysis is something else. And for an HR individual to be able to add this, just enhances the data analysis so much more, and you can present it in such a better way to the management in a story format, again, as you said, Sridhar. So we are almost nearing the end of the session, Sridhar, and lots of takeaways for me personally, for sure. Anything that you would want to, kind of add and wrap up the session, so to say?
Yeah, sure, Anjali. And thanks for the opportunity, first of all. And to wrap up the session, one thing I make sure is data analytics is science. We are analyzing the data in order to make conclusions about the information what we have. The first thing to get the information right is, it's we need to have the different types of information, like skills and qualifications of the individual, measures of particular competences, trainings attended. Every data point is helpful for HR. From as I mentioned, from the day he comes for an interview, he or she comes for an interview, till the day they leave the organization. Every data point helps in getting a good decision-making thing. That is, you can use the data, but it has to be a right way to use it, and you should see how we can present the data also. We need to understand and present the data is more important things which we have. And as I'm initially telling, and even now I will go with the same thing, where without an experience, if a fresher who wants to get into data analytics, it would be really it might help him in understanding the procedure, and but until unless he has some experience, they will not be able to put it in the right way.
Sure, absolutely. It was an absolute pleasure to have you with us today, Sridhar. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. I know you're juggling.
Yeah, same here, Anjali. And it was really helpful. And it's my pleasure to get interacting with these many people and answering the questions. Hope I have answered at least a bit.
I'm sure you have. I'm sure it's been very useful. So, you know, while I think we cannot emphasize enough that getting the best out of our people is not a new idea, but now I think we should all feel very fortunate that we have better tools to harness the power of our people, so to say, and then work towards, you know, creating greater riches for our businesses, for our organizations, and for us. So on that note, thank you so much, everybody, once again, for being here with us. Thank you for your awesome questions. Please take care and stay safe. Look after yourselves and your families. Thank you so much. Have a great time ahead.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.